after the singing of from the choir, after the choir minister, our speaker for today, with the word of God that will accomplish that which is set forth to do, Minister Reid will come to be the day's messenger, one that God has chosen for today, and we'll welcome her after the singing.
Thank you. God, our Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I come to you. I thank you for this afternoon. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your mercies. Thank you that you have brought the family back together to feast yes. at your table. I pray that you speak to me and through me. Yes. I pray, God, that the words that I shall say will edify your people, Hallelujah. Will draw them close to you, souls will come to know you, and will be ready for yes. your kingdom. Bless everything which I say today, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. This afternoon I greet Bishop Reid, the other ministers, brethren, and children, visitors, if there are any, in the name of Jesus. I am glad for the opportunity to be in the house of God. It is very cold and slippery on the outside, but I'm sure that as believers, with Jesus sitting on the throne of our hearts, then there's warmth. Or the songwriter said, there's summer in my heart. I'll share with you today from the word of God. It comes to us from the book of Isaiah, which was read by Sister Green. And I'll take my time since we are not hurrying to go anywhere. And there's meal next door, so we don't have to go home and cook. The theme I'll use is, whenever God speaks, it is so. Whenever God speaks, it is so. And Brother Coron had just sung a very fitting song to that effect. Whenever God speaks, it is so. Many regard Isaiah as the theologian of the Old Testament. His description of God and the divine attributes and acts in history are both profound and beautiful. Yet, Isaiah is not a theologian of the abstract. He applies his apprehension of God's nature and purpose to the practical issues confronting Israel. According to Dillard and Longman, some of his themes he highlights are one, God as the Holy One of Israel, because when he was called to his prophetic ministry in the year that King Uzziah died, he said he saw the Lord seated high and exalted on his throne, surrounded by seraphs, calling out, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." The prophet's experience in his cause set the tone for the remainder of his ministry. Throughout the book, Isaiah's favorite designation for God is the Holy One of Israel. Yes, yes. Outside of Isaiah, this phrase occurs only 6 times in the remainder of the Old Testament. Other themes are God as Savior and Redeemer, the remnant theme, which Pastor sometimes uses as the few in Sardis, and the servant of the Lord. Whenever God speaks, it is so. The kind of society and communities we are living in sometimes make it impossible to take people at their word. From those who are in leadership to the beggars on the street, truth is subjective. For many politicians, the promises they made will not be kept, or will be kept just until they are placed in office. Then we have the evolution of the new coined phrases of misspoke, alternative fact, or just say, this is the way I saw it. I'm so glad that whenever God speaks, it is so. Amen. Since we are living in a pluralistic society, where we are called upon to respect and perhaps accept everyone's religion, I believe it is necessary to say who this God is. He is the creator and redeemer of humankind. He rules over everything external to him, and so he's called Adonai. He is a transcendent being, superhumanly strong, and with inexhaustible life in himself, one on whom everything that is not himself depends, and he's called Elohim or El Elyon. Yahweh is God's personal name for himself. When God first stated this name to Moses at the burning bush, he explained as meaning, I am what I am, or perhaps most accurately, I will what I will be. This was a declaration of self-determining existence, as seen in Exodus 3, 14 through 15. Our God is merciful and gracious. Bible says he's slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. He forgives iniquity, transgressions, and sins, but he will by no means clear the guilty. He is marvelously kind and patient, like some parents, but also awesomely stern, just the way we would like all parents to be. God is the Father of Jesus Christ and of Christians through Christ as the God of the Old Testament, the only God there is. There is no God but Jehovah. Amen. Our salvation is the fulfillment of God's Old Testament promises. God is eternal. God is Father. God is a guide. He is impartial. He is infinite. He is invisible. He is incomprehensible. He is a preserver. He is unchangeable. Yes. Whenever God speaks, it is so. Amen. Isaiah 55 opens with an invitation from God, which was just too good to be true, and we would perhaps say too good to refuse. It was also an urgent invitation. It's the kind of invitation which is offered from this pulpit every Sunday, but very few accept. On the other hand, if we are posted an invitation, or if an invitation is posted somewhere, let's say on the block, and it says, if you show up at this particular place between 3 a.m. and 5 a.m., you will get $2,000. It doesn't matter how cold it is, you would be there. And I'm sure somebody is saying, I wish that was really true. And even you have started out to think what you would wear so you'd be kept warm. Because it's a free $2,000. The great proclamation which was made, it began with the word hope. And according to the society we live in, we could have getting great problems, a great trouble, if we say the word ho to the wrong person. Now, only Santa Claus is allowed to say ho, ho, ho. But if we say it, then it's a problem. But here, Isaiah was like the town crier. He was saying, hey, yes. I need your attention. Yes. Like preachers today, some of them really extend their voices because they need your attention. It's not like on the train where you hear, sorry for the interruption, they need your attention. But here, Hosea is saying, oh, hey, listen, I need your attention. I need everyone to look at me. I need everyone to listen to me. Because, see, this invitation was wide, but yet personal. It was inclusive. So every person was included. It doesn't matter what kind of sin you have committed. It doesn't matter how old you are. Doesn't matter how young you are. Doesn't matter your race. You are included. So he wanted everybody to hear. Now, sometimes a family gets an invitation, and although you are six in the family, only one person is invited. Or the invitation may say, no children allowed. Or it may say, well, you know, I don't really know your husband or your wife, so don't bring him, don't bring her. And then that sort of creates a problem. Because, of course, if you're going somewhere, you know, you want to bring somebody with you. But if you decide you're going to take it upon yourself and bring your children because you didn't have a babysitter, then that's a problem. But here, if you are invited to church, not many people say, I'm going to bring my spouse. Oh, it's wonderful that you invite me. I'm going to bring all my children. It's not the kind of invitation people welcome readily. And they say, I am going to make sure my family is coming with me. But Isaiah was saying, this invitation is from God. Yes. I'm his voice to you. Yes. And it includes everybody. Don't leave your children at home. Don't leave your spouse at home. Yes, he has never been to church. She has never been to church. But I need them to come because I have a special invitation from the Lord. The invitation begins by saying, if you are thirsty, if you are thirsty. Now, I believe everyone here understands what it means to thirst. You may thirst for different things, but thirst is sometimes something everyone experiences. So he says, if you are thirsty, I need you to come. If you are in New York State and you are thirsty, I need you to come. If you are anywhere in the world and you are thirsty, I need you to come. Doesn't depend where you are. I need you to come. If you are incarcerated and you are thirsty, I need you to come. If you are chained by sin and you are thirsty, I need you to come. Now, every humankind alive, as I said, you have experienced thirst. When you're truly thirsty, no Coca-Cola, no ginger beer, no pineapple juice can quench the thirst. You need pure water. There is no substitute for a real thirst. Psalm 42 says, my soul thirsteth for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before him? For as a deer panteth after the water brook, so panteth my soul after thee, O God. This kind of thirst can't be mistaken for anything else. Sisters and brothers, my pre-Christian friends, this thirst makes you restless. And you will, it can't be quenched until you get that real water. It's a thirst for the grace of God. So Isaiah says, if you are thirsty, come. Secondly, he says, come ye to the waters. And notice the word. He didn't say come to the water. He said come to the waters. It means there is an abundant supply. Hallelujah. It's an abundant supply. I need you to come to the waters. Come and be satisfied. Come for what God has for you. Only Jesus Christ will satisfy this desire. When you're experiencing real thirst, as I said, your throat is going to be dry. You feel parched. Yes. And no matter what you drink, organic, non-GMO, low sodium, low sugar drink, none of them will quench your thirst until you get the wheat. So he says, come eat to the waters. And if you have no money, come. Now, everything is free. Who would not want something that's free? When we have pantry on Tuesdays, even if we pack 85 bags, we are going to have 100 people. And they're still going to come and they say we need it. But unfortunately, with our situation is those who need come and those who don't really need it will come. This gift, this free gift, is for those who are in need. If you need, you will come. So he says, come even if you have no money. If you are penniless, come. So it's something I would expect everything to go for. Only God himself could have given this gift.
That's right.
You don't have to pay for it. You don't have to pay for it. Just come. It's ready. All you have to do is come. So he said, come to the waters. And if you have no money, still come. So you need water. You are thirsty. And you have no money to buy it, but come. See, if you're from the West Indies like I am, and there are times when you experience drought, there's no water, and you have to go by the gate and wait for the water truck to come, so you get water, put it on your head, and climb back up the hill.
That's right.
There are other people who were more fortunate than us, so they had a river, or they have pipes somewhere. Oh, they have spring, or tanks at home. Some of us didn't have that. And even when we have tanks, the drought is so bad that there's no water. So you have to go and wait until the truck comes. The truck is going to come 2 o'clock. You better get down there early before the neighbors. And you wait for that water in your container, and you're extra careful. Because when you're going up the hill, you may just slip or slide, and you lose your water. But because you know what it means to need water and not have it,
then when you get it, you're going to be careful with it. Praise the name of Jesus. When you are thirsty and you get that water, you are going to make sure you take care of it. You don't want to lose it. So you are careful with the way you walk.
Thank you, Lord.
You don't play when you are going up the hill because you don't want to lose that water. So the prophet says, if you want the water,
yes,
come. Come and get it. Everything is in abundant supply. So you come. Nothing is limited. Come and take it. No one will call you greedy. No one will say you are selfish because you won't be taking anyone else's water. It's yours. It's for the individual. I said it's for everybody, but it has an individual call. So you come and get your own water. The prophet was not speaking of natural water in this sense. He was not speaking of natural wine. He was not speaking of natural milk. Because I don't want people to complain and say, well, you know what? I don't like plain water anyway. I don't drink wine anyway. And I'm lactose intolerant. So it's not the natural stuff. I need to lift you to the other level. The prophet was also acquainted with the fact that water was a scarce commodity in Canaan. So the other places, they had rivers. They didn't have that. They had rain, but it was seasonal. So when they talk about water, they understood what that meant. According to Delitzsch, one of my favorite theologians or Bible scholars, he says that water, wine, and milk are figurative representations of spiritual revival, recreation, and nourishment. 1 Peter 2 verse 2 says, as newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the word that he may grow thereby. When God calls the thirsty ones to come to the water, it's more than when the shepherd leads the sheep to drink. Buying without money tells us it's not natural objects. Wine and milk are divine blessings of grace. In order to receive it, you must first feel the sense of need and must have the readiness to accept the offer. You are poverty, but this gift is in abundant supply. This invitation comes through Christ when he's seeking for those who are spiritually lost. Come and buy. Come, everyone. Procure and receive that which is freely offered. Come, get your wine and milk so that you can experience the blessings of Jesus Christ. Those are far much better than natural wine and milk. It is said that water refreshes, wine gladdens, and milk nourishes. Now, the love of God is better than wine. The word of God is better than milk. What do you need today? Do you need the natural wine or the spiritual wine? Do you need the love of God? Do you need the word of God? What do you need? What is your need? Isaiah says, you're to come. You have no money. There's no need to complain.
Amen.
Many times we need things, but we can't get it. We can't buy it because we have no money in the bank.
Oh, yes.
But God knows that we are all spiritually bankrupt.
Yes.
And
yes.
So he says, we can't buy the blessings, so we are to come. In verse 2, he says, wherefore do ye spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfieth not? Hearken diligently unto me, and eat ye that which is good, and let your soul delight itself in fatness. He tells you, you can come without money.
Yes.
Because you have already spent your money anyway for that which is not bread. That which does nothing for you. That which does benefit you. That which does not satisfy.
Yes, yes.
You are spending everything you have in the world seeking satisfaction. And nothing you have gotten has satisfied you. So he says, you want satisfaction? Come. Many of us are destitute. Destitute. And we have not even realized that. We haven't realized that we are spiritually destitute. We need something more. We are thirsty and we don't realize that. Hungry, we don't realize that. But the call is coming to you. Come.
Amen.
I will give you what you need. I will satisfy that need. So need to come. It's a general invitation. In Matthew 22 and verse 4, scripture says, and again he sent forth other servants saying, tell them that are bidden, behold, I have made ready my dinner. My oxen and my fatlings are killed, and all things are ready. Come to the marriage feast. The call still goes out today. It is God who is calling you. Don't hesitate. Don't make excuses. Your bill is already paid. Just come. In John 6 and verse 35, Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst. So come. If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. Those who have a personal relationship with Christ have already experienced what he provides.
Yes.
We can't earn it. Neither can we buy something which is not for sale. So God says, come. Why do you spend money for that which is not bread? He asked. You are so involved in the things of the world, making a lot of sacrifices. We are not satisfied by the many things we have acquired. We are not happy. We become despondent. And then the problem is we lash out at God. We blame him. The one who loves you most. He's calling you back to himself. That's always the case. Has to be God. You look at what happens in our society. When there's a catastrophe, it's God, it's his fault. Why didn't he do something about it? And unfortunately, with us as believers, when we walk in our own selfish ways, and God has to rein us in, we start blaming him too. Blaming him for problems of our own making. In verse 3, scripture says, incline your ear and come unto me. Hear and your soul shall live. And I will make an everlasting covenant with you, even the secure mercies of David. Incline your ear. Hear and your soul shall live. In order to hear God today, you must incline your ear to him. You must incline your ear to hear him. Why do you think a number of people could sit in here today and some people go out not understanding what was said or not even hearing what was said because they have not inclined their ear to hear what the Lord is saying? When you have inclined your ear, it tells me you are willing and you are ready, you are prepared, and you have the right attitude to hear what God is saying to you. Listen diligently, he says. Don't leave here and not hearing what God was saying to you. Listen diligently. How do you listen when you come to the house of God? One person is hearing Sister Reid, and the other person is hearing what God is saying. Listen diligently. Incline your ear to the Lord. You're not allowed to come to the house of God and not hear what the sower is saying. If your ears are not inclined, neither will your soul be ready for the sower. Pastor spoke to us about that recently. Jesus said, I have spoken to you. Your life, he said, hear, Jesus said, hear me and your soul shall live. The covenant which I have made, first with Abraham, then with David, I'm making with you.
Amen.
You will get all the glorious blessings. Best of all, the chief blessing, which was Christ coming to die for us. Listen so that your soul can live. if you have not inclined your ear, if you are not listening, if you are not hearing what the Lord is saying to you, then your soul will not live. That's the most important part of you, your soul. You want the soul man to live. And unless you incline your ear, you will not live. Behold, I have given him for a witness to the people, a leader and commander. Now, in the scripture, you notice that David was mentioned. Behold, I have given him, David, for a witness to the people, and a leader and commander for the people. Behold, thou shalt call a nation that thou knowest not, and nations that knew not thee shall run unto thee because of the Lord thy God and for the Holy One of Israel, for he hath glorified thee. Now, very often the scripture is read and it is said that in verses 4 and 5, where David is mentioned, one, the first David is David, the king, and the second one is the Messiah. However, usually when the Messiah is mentioned, the scripture says son of David. So David in the first part is God is talking about the past history of David. Mm-hmm. The past history of David. In the second is David in the future. He did not say son of David. So that's what he's showing us through what he has done to David, how David related to him in the past, and what is going to happen, what David will be in the future, representing what Jesus will be to us in the future. But not that in this particular scripture, David was the Messiah. Amen?
Amen.
Okay. Now, according to the text, we see that salvation is available to all. In verses 6 and 7, it says, seek ye the Lord because he may be found. Call upon him because he is near. That's the interpretation of what's there. It really says, seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. It says, seek ye the Lord because he may be found. Call upon him because he is near.
Yes.
God is not lost. He's not gone anywhere.
Yes.
So it's seek ye the Lord because he may be found. He may be found. He's not gone anywhere. So don't just read the scripture and say, well, seek ye the Lord while he may be found. He's not going to go anywhere. He's here. It's because the translation, it's because he may be found. Call upon him because he is near. Repent before you die, because after death, there is no conversion of the soul. Repent before you die, because after death, there is no conversion of the soul. Have you called upon him lately? Have you spoken to him about your situation? Have you spoken to him about the struggles you are going through? Have you spoken to him about the thirst and the hunger that you feel? Seek the Lord because he may be found.
Yes.
Call upon him because he is near. Now, the banquet of God's grace is free and abundant, but it's also conditional. The banquet of God's grace is free, but it's also conditional. Scripture says, let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts.
Amen.
And let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. It is conditional. The banquet is free, but it's conditional. It's abundant, but it is conditional. Now, if we are invited to a special place, and it is said that we are to wear formal clothing, and we show up, let's say I show up in a jean skirt and a t-shirt, and I'm not allowed to go in, it's because I didn't follow the instructions, right? There are conditions. In the same way, the banquet is prepared.
Yes.
But it's for those who have forsaken their wicked ways.
Forsaken.
You must forsake your wicked ways. We have to do some adjustment.
Amen.
Amen.
And then when we have made the adjustment, then our opportunities will be unlimited. We have to become intentional about forsaking our wicked ways. The door is open, but we have to make the adjustment. Bible said, let the wicked forsake his ways, and not just the wicked ways, but the unrighteous man his thoughts. Now, you can always see wicked people doing wicked things, and you say, oh, that person is wicked. You don't see the thoughts of the righteous man.
Amen.
So the man can look all well and good on the outside,
but
then his thoughts are unrighteous.
Right.
Thank God he is able to see the thoughts of humankind.
Amen.
Because then we can look at a group of people and we say, oh, this person is wonderful.
Great.
This is great. This is, but then we don't know the thoughts.
Amen.
And that's why the Bible says, let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. We need a whole life alignment when we come to Jesus Christ. Whole life, total life alignment, total readjustment. We are wicked people.
Oh yes.
The heart is desperately wicked.
Yes.
I mean, we weren't born saints. We were not born saints. We have done wicked things. Sometimes we feel like we were all righteous. No, we weren't. We were wicked people. Jesus Christ came into our lives and transformed us. And when he called us, we responded to the invitation. We were willing to make the adjustment. We realigned our whole lives. And we decided, we were intentional about walking with him. And that's what makes the difference. But we were wicked.
Yes.
We thought about horrible things.
Yes.
We probably didn't do them, but the sin was already committed in the heart. We were wicked people. That's what the scripture says. But I'm glad that God is merciful. And he said if we come to him, he will have mercy upon us. When he speaks, it is so. He's not going to change it. This is what I'm going to do. If you forsake your wicked ways and your unrighteous thoughts, then when you come to me, I will have mercy on you. And you get abundant pardon. So it doesn't matter how many sins you have. When you bring it to him, there's abundant pardon. So keep coming. Keep coming until you are clean. Keep coming until you get that thought process right. Keep coming until that wickedness is out of you, that wicked ways. Keep coming because he says, I will have mercy and I will have abundant pardon for you. When we sin against our brothers and sisters, it's not that easy. Sometimes we go many times saying, I'm really sorry to hurt you. And I don't even want to hear it. And every time you make a mistake, it comes back to you. But you did this last week. And you said this to me the other day. And I didn't like it. But thank God he's not like that.
Abundant
pardon. Abundant pardon. And that's why when we fail him, we don't sit in our sins. We run back to him. Because there is abundant pardon. Praise the name of Jesus. I'm so happy that God is not like my brother and sister. If not, every time I lift my hands to praise the Lord, somebody would be beating me over my head and say, but you did this and you did that. Thank God my sins are in the sea of forgetfulness. My past life is behind me. I know there are some people who like to remind you of those things. The things you used to do. What you were with before you came to Jesus Christ. But I'm not that person anymore. Hallelujah. I am not that person anymore. Because he had mercy on me. And abundant pardon. Glory to Jesus. So when I came to him, I repented of my sins. I asked him to remove my wicked ways. Cleanse me from my unrighteous thoughts. And I was intentional about walking with him in holiness. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Some of us, although we have come to Jesus Christ, we have not yet realigned our life with him. So we kind of use him as a garnish. You know when you get a meal and they put garnish on the plate? You don't even eat it. It's there. It's decoration. So the parsley or whatever they put there, it's on the side. And that's how we are with him. You know, you stay right here, you carry him here, and that's all he is, a garnish. So you say, I have Jesus, but he doesn't have you. Because we have not realigned our lives. I mean, total life realignment. We have not made that adjustment. So we carry him, probably we carry a Bible, or we wear a chain, a cross. But we have not yet realigned our lives with him. Jesus must be our feast, not just the garnish on the plate. He must be our feast. He must be our defining center. And when we have that kind of relationship, then we know we can move in his direction. Sisters and brothers, that's what God wants from us. He's telling you what he wants. He's not going to change it. There's a song they sing, we can't cut it and trim it. He is not going to change it. We have to align ourselves to him. He's not going to come down to our level. In verse 8, he says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways, saith the Lord. That's what God says.
Amen.
Whatever he says, it is so.
Right.
My thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are my ways your ways, saith the Lord. Whatever he says, it is so. Our thoughts are wrong.
Amen.
Our ways and thoughts exalt ourselves, make us feel special, independent of God. But he says, let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Everything about us was wrong. Everything about us. There was nothing holy, nothing pure. In Revelation 3:17, it says, because thou sayest, I am rich and have gotten riches, and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art the wretched one, and miserable, and poor, and blind, and naked. That's the state that we were in. Exalting ourselves. We are rich, and we have everything. And God is saying, no, you have nothing. Nothing. You are wretched. You are miserable. You are poor and you are naked. Destitute. That's the state we're in. And that's why we needed him. That's why we needed him. Because we could not help ourselves. There's nothing we can do to help. We could have done to help ourselves. We were not pure. We were filthy. And we could not help ourselves. And so the invitation comes. He has many other promises, and he won't go back on his word. But we have to align ourselves to him. We have to make that adjustment. Total life, total whole life adjustment. So I can't fix one area of my life and not fix the other. I can't fix the outside and not fix the heart. And for many of us, we do that. We fix the outside so we are able to act the part. But we have not fixed the heart. We have not allowed him to fix the heart. We have not allowed him to sit on the throne of our hearts. I'll read you a quote from a Bible scholar. His name is Raymond Ortlund, O-R-T-L-U-N-D. He says that we are so tolerant of our sins, especially if we maintain a superficial technical righteousness. But we have lost the radical edge of real Christianity in our generation. I hope we are not beyond recovery. We may be. We have forgotten that Christianity is so contrary to our ingrained likes and dislikes. It requires nothing less than a transformation of the magnitude of a religious conversion. He says, we American Christians can't just tweak our American ways and American thoughts. We can't just make a decision for Christ and leave it at that. We can't join a certain church because it won't challenge our selfish lifestyle and think that's Christianity. Being nice, harmless, church-going people with no repentance, no submission, no forsaking of self, no pursuit of Christ, but all that covered over with a glaze of sentimental religion on Sunday mornings. This is not at all what God has in mind for us. Could the average church today fit in the book of Acts? The psychology of too many churches, both liberal and conservative, is so filled with certainty about ourselves that there is no room for openness to God. We have drifted from the gospel, and we don't have forever to get back.
My God.
That's a warning. That's a warning.
Drifted.
I am happy that God is showing us today the way to get back. He says, and I read that before, verses 6 and 7, he says, seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our God he'll abundantly pardon. That's the cure for that. Unfortunately, in many churches, this can't be preached. This can't be preached because people won't come back. But God wants us back. He wants to give us a complete overhaul. He wants us. He is asking us to place our lives under scrutiny, to look at ourselves again and see where we are standing. We fail to live the life that represents the power of his grace. All we have to do is to humbly accept his call and follow through in repentance and return to God. That's all he's asking. That's not too much to ask. That's not too much. He says he'll forgive you. And if he says he'll forgive you, he will forgive you. Whatever he says, it is so. You don't have to be afraid in going to him. If he says he'll forgive you, he will. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, said the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts. That's a big gap. The gap is very wide. As the heavens is above the earth, the gap is too wide. Too wide. We may not be able to do anything about our lives, but we must understand that our lives matter to God.
That's right. Amen.
So think about that. What does God want from me? What does he want me to do? What in my life he wants me to fix? Because we may say, you know, I can't do anything. But if God tells us, yes, he wants us to start re-examining our feelings, yes, and our well-established habits. For some of us, the things that we do over and over, they become as, although they are sinful, they become as nothing because they are well-established habits. We do them every day. So it becomes the norm. So it's asking us to look at our feelings and our well-established habits, the ones we do every day, day in, day out. And it doesn't bother us. But he's asking us today, put ourselves under scrutiny. Let me scrutinize myself. I'm not going to scrutinize you. You scrutinize yourself. I scrutinize myself. Put ourselves under scrutiny. Look at our feelings. Check our feelings. And check our well-established habits. If we submit ourselves humbly to his word, God will surprise us. He will surprise us. He'll make us brand new. He will transform our lives again, and we will become the people he wants us to be. There's a story I read, let me see if I can find it, about someone who, after reading the word, he puts his own life under scrutiny. I probably didn't have it. I have it. Okay, this is it. Okay, someone will relay a story which was told to him. And I think it's worth sharing because it's after reading the word he was able to put his own life under scrutiny. So it goes, Claude told me about an experience he had with God in his word. One morning he was reading his daily Bible reading from Psalm 37. He had read this psalm many times before. But on this particular morning, the Holy Spirit called his attention to verse 21. The wicked borrows and does not repay. He was drawn back to that verse. He was drawn back to that verse and he read it again. At that very moment, he remembered borrowing $500 from his parents with a promise to repay them when he got his next paycheck. Now, months later, he had almost forgotten about the debt. God used Psalm 37:21 to remind him of the unpaid debt. More importantly, God alerted Claude that wicked are the ones who borrow and don't pay, repay. Claude said, I prayed and I asked the Lord to forgive me. And then I wrote a check for $500 and delivered it to my parents. The Holy Spirit had spoken to him through that verse. He encountered truth. Now he understood that those who borrow and do not repay are wicked in God's sight. Yes. The Holy Spirit had called his attention to a specific instance where this verse applied to him. This was the Holy Spirit convicting him of sin. The Holy Spirit is the one who does that. Claude responded to the Lord in a prayer of confession. Then he adjusted to the truth, yes, paid the debt, and was reconciled to his parents and to the Lord. He realigned himself. He confessed his sins to the Lord. He realized that it was sinful. It was sinful. So sometimes the little things that we overlook as nothing, and we are happy on our way to heaven and not realizing that they are sinful. They are sins, because the Bible, it's God who says it, you know. He says that the wicked borrows and does not repay. It's sinful. That is what God says. When I was reading a book and I saw it and I said, this is part of realigning myself to the word. I read the word. I let the word speak to me. There is no need to read the word if you're not, if it's not cleaning you, if it's not purifying your heart, if it's not washing you. You don't read the word because, you know, I may be asked if I read my Bible today and I need to be able to say yes. That's not why we read the word. So this brother read the word, and God reminded him through the Holy Spirit, listen, you borrowed $500 from your parents, and you told them that you would pay back at your next paycheck, and that was many paychecks ago. He didn't fight. He said, God, I'm guilty. I'm guilty. Whatever God says, it is so. If he call, if he says I'm wicked because I didn't repay a loan, I am wicked. It's not the preacher. It's the word. That is what God says, that we cannot fix it. We can't say, you know, I cannot say to the brethren that God says they are wicked if they borrow and they do not repay. I can't change that. Yes, it may sound harsh, but that's what God says. And sometimes when we try to make it mild, change what God says, it doesn't work. Because that's not what he says. So we are not going to try to fix it to make you feel comfortable. So then, when I saw this, I don't think I owe anybody here anything, but I hope not. But if I do, you can see me.
Yes, fix it.
No, if I do, you can see me. If I borrow something from you and I don't remember, then, you know, I need to fix it. And if you are here and you are in this situation, then you need to fix it. Because God says you are wicked. You can't be going to heaven and God call you wicked. You're not going to make it there. You are not going to make it there because God says you are wicked. So we fix it and we go on. That's the word of the Lord. That's not Sister Reid. That's what God says. That we need to realign our whole lives. So we fix it. So nobody goes from here and saying, as Sister Reid said, no, God. It's the word. It's the word. And if God said so, it is so. It is so. Too many times we try to sugarcoat stuff, and that's why we don't get it. You know, sometimes when you try to sugarcoat it too much, the person you're talking to, they don't understand. And they walk away from you still not understanding what you're saying to them. But use the word. Use the word. Just say what God says and leave it alone. If they don't understand, you can explain it. But use the word. So I'm hoping that I'm not guilty as I stand before you. But if I am, then you can talk to me. I'll fix it, I promise you. Because I need to go to heaven. And if God calls me wicked, it means I'm not going to go there. I'm not going to go there. So, you know, I promise you, I'll fix it. Now, it's an urgent call for repentance. It's an urgent call. Let me get back my scripture up here. It's an urgent call for repentance. You may not have tomorrow. You may not have another day. It's an urgent call for repentance. Now, in verse 10, he says, for as the rain cometh down and the snow from heaven and returneth not thither, but watereth the earth and maketh it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. Mm-hmm. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. Whatever God says, it is so.
It is so.
It is so. It is so. Now, God, the analogy which is used is the water cycle. So the rain comes down. Mm-hmm. By precipitation, the rain comes down, falls from the cloud, it comes down to the earth, it's going to water the plants and the seed, and it's going to bring forth, right? And then, by the process of evaporation, it's going to go back up, and when the clouds are filled again with water, then it's going to fall as rain. Now, God is saying, so is my word.
Oh, yes.
When I speak, it is so. Whatever I need my word to perform, it will perform it. It will perform it. So you take him at his word. Whatever he says, it is so. What does he say to you about your own life? Do you doubt him? Do you believe what he says? What has he said to you? And you're still doubt, and you say, God, you said this to me many years ago, and it has not come to pass. What has he said to you about your own life? And you are saying, God, there has to be some, because I haven't experienced it yet. You want God to work for you, then you have to believe that what he says, it is so. You have to hold on to
Hallelujah.
That. When your back is against the wall, you say, God,
yes,
whatever you say, it is so.
Thank you.
You feel like you're falling down, yes. You can't walk, you can't move, you need a shoulder to lean on. God, I'm standing on your word. Whatever
Hallelujah.
You say, it is so.
Amen.
It doesn't matter how dark it gets, God. Whatever you say, God, it is so. Can you tell yourself that today? Can you put your hand on your chest and say, God, whatever you say, it is so. Accept it in your spirit. It's not just speaking from your mouth. Accept it in your spirit. God, whatever you have said to me, I believe you, God. It is so. No devil can derail it because God says it. Praise the name of Jesus. Whatever he has said to me, it is so. He says in chapter 40 and verse 8, he declared, the grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Brethren, God's promises will last. He says it is so, it is so. And his promises will give life. Always remember that. The word of Jehovah goes out from his mouth.
Yes, yes.
It goes, it's sent down to us. And it's going to perform, accomplish whatever he sent it to do. Whatever God says, it is so.
Oh, glory.
Sometimes I believe the invitation he gives is too simple. So that, there are people who don't believe it. How could a holy God do so much for me, a sinful person? But he's still calling and still seeking. You have heard what he had to say today. You are without excuse. The word of God is not a mere sound. It's not a mere letter. It goes forth out of his mouth. It takes shape. It has divine life because it's from a divine origin. It runs with life from God, endowed with divine power, supplied with divine commission, and like a swift messenger, through nature and the world of man, there to melt the ice, as it were, and here to heal and save. And it does not return from its course till it has given effect to the will of the sender.
Yes.
It does what God tells it to do. Snow and rain cause things to grow, and therefore we are able to enjoy what is reaped. So is the soil of the human heart softened, refreshed, and rendered productive or prolific by the word of the mouth of Jehovah. The word furnishes the prophet or the preacher who resembles the sower with the seed, which he scatters and brings it with bread, which feeds the soul. Every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God is bread. Deuteronomy 8 and verse 3. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. For he shall go out with joy and be led forth with peace.
Yes.
The mountains and the hills shall break forth before you into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the fir tree, and instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle tree, and it shall be to the Lord for a name, for an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. That's the promises.
Yes.
For joy he will go forth. Now God promises not only God doesn't promise only things in this life. Not only things in this life, but in order for us to attain or achieve the things in the future, then we have to accept the invitation he is now giving and make the adjustment. He says that after you have come to him, after you have repented of your sins, you shall have joy.
Joy.
Yes. You're going to be happy. The thorns in your life will be gone. The briar in your life will be gone. What are those things that cause you the most trouble?
Hallelujah.
The thorns, the thistles, the briars. They will be gone. Eve nature is going to join you.
Yes.
You see things differently because you have come to Jesus Christ. God promised to make all things new. All things. The vegetation and the desert will be transformed. All things will be new. You won't live in fear anymore. You'll be in peace. Because he promised to make all things new. Why is it so hard to believe God? Why is it so hard? You believe he created the universe.
Yes.
So why is it so hard to believe that when he gives this invitation, he meant every word he said? Why is it so hard to believe that everyone is included?
Yes.
Those who we may push to the side or ostracize, they are included. Everyone. You believe that he created light on the first day. Light. Light on the first day. You also believe that he created lights on the fourth day. The sun, the moon, and the stars. You believe those things.
Yes.
Is it too simple? Is salvation too simple? You believe those things. You believe all those things that God has done. Why is it so hard to believe that when you come to him, whatever he says to you, it is so? There are other people in the Bible who believe God, who took him at his word.
Amen.
Bible tells us about a leper who Jesus met. And the leper understood that if all he had to say was the word, and it would be so. All he had to say the word, and it was a leper who was living by himself. He was excommunicated from society. But he believed that if Jesus just said the word, it would be so. So when he saw Jesus Christ, he said, "Sir, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean." Yes, people thought that Jesus shouldn't even have touched him, but he touched him. And he said, "Yes, I will. Be thou clean." Whatever God says, it is so. Are you sick today? Are you ailing? Do you believe that just a word from the Master,
hallelujah,
you can be healed? He then told him, "Go show yourself to the priest." He must have been perfectly whole, because it means walking from Galilee to Jerusalem to show himself to the priest. He will make you whole. Perfectly whole. He is able to make dead come back to life. When Lazarus died, all he had to say was the word, and it was so. All he had to say, Lazarus, come forth. Are there dead things in our lives today that we need to be resurrected? Whatever God says, it is so. He just needs to speak the word. Now, there are people who experience what I would call a crisis of belief.
Yes.
So although the word is preached, they're at the point where like a crossroads, and they can't pass it. But if you're at that point, you'll have to believe that God is who he says he is. You'll have to believe that God can do what he says he will do. You'll have to adjust your thinking in light of this belief. You'll have to trust that God will demonstrate who he says he is. And then you obey him. Then you'll know God by experience. You will know who he is and who he says he is. Abraham knew in his mind that God was almighty.
Hallelujah.
He knew he was almighty experientially when in his old age he was able to have a child. You say, well, yes, I'm going through a crisis of belief, but I mean, how do I know that God is speaking?
Praise God.
How do I know that God is speaking? Some of us, we are waiting for the evangelist to come and pick us out of the seat and say, you stand and prophesy over our lives. But God is speaking to you today. He's speaking to you today. He's speaking to you today. He speaks through his servant.
Praise God.
He speaks through the Bible.
Amen. Is going forth. Hallelujah. Amen.
Like the brother who said that the scripture spoke to him and he was able to realign his life. The Bible is God's word. You read the word of God. It should speak to you.
Yes.
The spirit of truth takes the word of God and reveals truth to you as you read. You adjust your life to the truth of God. You obey him. Then God will work in you and through you to accomplish his purpose. Whenever God speaks, it is so. You have to speak. Listen to what God is saying. Listen to what he's saying. He speaks to you in prayer. He speaks to you in the circumstances of your life. He speaks to you when you come to church. Why is it you are saying you're not hearing from God? Why is it you're not realigning your life with his word? Probably you're listening to the wrong voice. Who are you listening to? God is speaking. Are you listening? When God speaks, it is so. When we respond to his invitation, we said before there'll be joy and peace. Where there was barrenness, there will be no more. There will be beautiful trees. When we accept God's word, we shall bring forth fruit. The thorns, as I said, will become fir trees and the briar myrtle trees. Are you longing to get rid of the thorns out of your life? Restless nights, sleepless nights. Troubled in spirit. But you can make the adjustment.
Thank you, Jesus.
You cannot stay where you are if you want to go with God. You must make the adjustment. If you're invited to attend a conference, say somewhere in Nigeria, and you leave your home and you sit at Kennedy Airport and you never got the required documents, you're not going anywhere.
Hallelujah.
You cannot stay where you are and go with God.
That's right.
You cannot stay where you are and go with God.
That's right.
Noah could not continue life as usual and be an ark. Abraham could not stay in Ur or Haran and father a nation in Canaan. David had to leave his sheep to become a king. Jonah had to leave his home and overcome major prejudice to preach in Nineveh. Matthew had to leave the tax collector's booth to follow Jesus. Everything must be yielded to God and the entire life adjusted to him. Even Jesus had to make adjustment. Scripture says, you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that you through his poverty might become rich. Until you're ready to make any adjustment necessary to follow and obey what God says, you will be of little use to God. You cannot stay where you are and go with him. You can't skip adjustment and go from believing to obedience. You must adjust first. The rich young ruler in Luke 18 had a problem. He didn't want to adjust. Jesus told him what to do, but he was not about to do that. But whatever God says, it is so. After you have accepted the invitation, you have passed your crisis in belief. You have understood that God speaks to you through his word, the Bible, to the church, through prayer, through circumstances of life. After you have realized that you cannot stay in the situation you are and go with God, you have to make that adjustment. Some of us have just to make adjustment on how we relate to our parents as young people. And not even just young people, but if you have parents. Because sometimes us adults, we don't care whether our parents live or die. So we have to make that adjustment. How we relate to our brethren. How we relate to people who we know do not like us. Do we resent them in return? Do we treat them badly? So we have to make that adjustment to fit in what God's plan is for us in the future. Revelation chapter 21 tells us about a part of what God has planned for us in the future. It says, there's a city where there will be no need for the light from the sun or the moon, because his glory will provide the light. Gentiles, as well as Israel and the church, will be there. It will be the dwelling place for saints of all ages. The gates of the city will never be shut. There will be no night there. Everything which is impure, shameful, or deceitful will be excluded. I invite you to accept the invitation.
Yes. Yes.
Allow Jesus to cleanse you with the water of his word.
Amen.
Let everything you do between then, be in now and then, be informed by the fact that whatever God says, it is so.
Amen.
Whenever he speaks, it is so. Let your everyday activities be done in a way that honors God.
Yes.
Bible tells us that Jesus will come as a thief in the night. It is so. God says it, and it is so. Something worse than 9/11 can happen at any moment to every unbelieving person, and the persons who are not consistent with their walk with the Lord.
Jesus.
If he comes and we are not ready, if he comes as a thief in the night and we are not ready, it will be worse than 9/11. Whatever God says, it is so. God bless you. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Hallelujah. There's nothing that I can add to this prophetic message. I believe God has clearly spoken to every heart. And it's a reason why God bring this message today. Hallelujah. And if you're here under the sound of my voice, and as the Bible says, he that hath an ear to hear, let him hear. I beg of you. I plead with you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. If you're in this building today and something is not right in your life, you're not in alignment with the word of God. Don't look at the person beside you. Don't look at your neighbor. This is when I want you to be very selfish now. Because I believe God through the Holy Ghost has spoken this word today. I feel this prophetic word going through my spirit. Hallelujah. And you see, people have a tendency, if you're not running up and down and screaming and yelling, they don't hear the word. But I believe God has outlined it so clear today that even the little children could understand. Whatever God says is so. God wants us to adjust to his word. If you're dealing with stuff, and our sister Reid talked about Christ of faith, sometimes as hardened Christians, older believers, you come to a point in your life where you doubt your faith. You doubt whether you're saved. It's called a crisis of faith. And during those times, people turn away from the foundation that they know. People wander and meander into sin. And before you know it, some never come back. They stay right there and they backslide. But I believe God is saying to us today through this message in a simple way. Make the adjustment. Let the word of God change you radically. You're not beyond repair because God sent this word to you. I feel this going through my spirit like a prophet, prophetess, declaring the word of God today. He that hath an ear to hear, let him hear. If you're right, and if you're responding to the word, and if you're okay, you don't have to worry. You preach with the preacher, you rejoice. But if you know that you're on the wrong side of the word today, I ask you, in the name of Jesus, don't leave this place before you fix it. Because something, a worse thing will come upon you. Don't leave here without getting the remedy that God has prescribed. And the remedy is the word. And the Bible says it is free. Praise God, it is paid for. Why would you delay? Why would you neglect this? The Holy Ghost is saying to you today. It's not because anybody wants to single you out. It's simply because God loves you and wants you for himself. So while we bow our heads and close our eyes, I'm going to ask you, if you're here, you'd like to join me at this altar, would you please come? No music. If you're here and you want to join me at this altar, God has spoken to your heart. Maybe you're going through a crisis of faith. And at this point, you're very vulnerable. And the enemy is talking to you. But God draw you aside today with this sobering message. Whatever God says, it is so. So I ask you now to come to an altar because I want to pray with you and for you. As you come, you just take a pad and kneel right up there and close at the altar. Young people, I especially recognize your faith. Help them to kneel right up there. Anybody else, would you come? You know, this is a prophetic word. Tomorrow might be too late. Tomorrow might be too late. The next minute might be too late. Whatever God says, it is so. Listen to me carefully. The Holy Spirit speak this word today to our minister Reid through her. But it's a collective word. Is there something you're dealing with that you think you know? My friend, you don't know more than the Word of God. You don't know more than the Bible. And God has spoken his word today. And all I can ask you, for your soul's salvation's sake, it's about your soul that you submit to the Lordship of God. Yield. Let it go. Give it to God. Turn it over to Jesus. If the Lord does not give you the green light, if the word of God stands in objection against it, don't even bring it up. If the word of God stands in opposition against it, don't even make it a part of your conversation. If the word of God approves it, I don't care what demons, devils may say, it is so in the word of God. Make the adjustment and say to yourself, I want to come in line with the word of God because I want the mulberry trees. I want the very nature itself to clap their hands. I want to break out of joy. Hallelujah. Because you can only find the joy breaking out when you say, yes, Lord, whatever you say, it is so. Absolutely, 100%. Your word is not contestable. Your word is not challengeable. Your word cannot be taken to court. Your word cannot be overturned. Whatever you say, it is so. Hallelujah. Praise God. Everyone that thirsts, you need more of God. You need more of his fullness, more of his glory, more of his power. You need more of him. You want to see his handiwork in your life. Just give him a chance again. Let go and let God. One more time, yield your vessel to him and let the word of God work through you. I am standing here as a witness to the word of God. Every time I hear a sermon like this, I recommit my life totally to his embrace because I want the best of God. Hallelujah. And so why don't you join me today in saying to him, all to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him. In his presence daily live. Search me, O God. And know my heart, I pray. Try me, O Savior. Know my thoughts today. See if there be some wicked ways in me. That's a harsh word, a hard word. But today, the Bible says that the unrighteous man forsake his ways. Let him forsake his wicked ways. And the unrighteous man his thoughts. There are some thinking that go on in our cranium that should not be there. But thank God, the word of God flushes them out today. Thank God, the Spirit of God enter into our secret chamber and flushes them out. Hallelujah. So we can leave an altar brand new. Hallelujah. I urge you, like myself, to begin talking to God. If you can, if there's space and you want to kneel, please kneel before the Lord. This is a corporate altar call. God is speaking generally and he's speaking specifically in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, we thank you. We thank you today for your servant who has declared your word today. We bow before your presence, O God. In a very special way, recognizing that you have talked to us and you declare that your word will not return to you void. Hallelujah. Your word will not return to you void, but will accomplish that which you have sent forth. Because of your love for humanity, your love for us, your love for us, your love for the church, your love for each and every one of us, you have reminded us again, Lord, of the authenticity of your word, the permanence of your word, the sovereignty of your word, hallelujah, that when you speak, your voice is unchallenged, hallelujah. Your authority is unchallenged, it's unquestioned, Lord. And so we bow before you, Master, in Jesus' name. Ask you, first of all, you'll wash us into those corners and those crevices of our hearts, which there might be things, God, that your word has shed a light on today. You ask us, Lord, to first let the wicked forsake his ways and the unrighteous man his thought. God, every way that we have today that is not right in your sight, every way that is not correct before a holy God, every thought that has not been right before you, every wayward thought, every wandering thought, every evil thought, every thought that is not aligned with your word, we come against them even now as we bow in this place, oh God, before your great throne, asking you to purge us. Hallelujah. We want to bring joy to you, Father. We want to please you, Daddy. We want to please you with our praise. We want our lives to please you every day, and the world may know Christ through us. Hallelujah. And we realize, God, that we cannot leave the way we came. Oh, God, if we want to go with you, we have got to grow with you. And your word tell us, dear Father, that in your sight, in your eyes, praise God, we are precious if we but purify our hearts. So I pray now, Father, you'll scrub us again with your word as you've done today, Lord. Give us the willingness to say, yes, Lord, I yield, I yield. I can't hold out no longer. Remember every person that bow before you, God. But I pray in particular for those who did not have a relationship with you, but today they have found the answer. Remember those who are going through crisis of faith, confused by the world and the condition around them. Lord, once again, you have lifted the page of your word and you have told us that whatever you say is so. So, Lord, we rest our case. We have no argument to oppose your word. We have no argument to oppose your authority and your will, because we want for our lives your sovereign will. So I pray upon this altar, I pray upon everyone that bow before you, God, that your sovereign will be done. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that your will, your sovereign will, your perfect will, Lord, nothing but your will for your lives be done in perfect harmony. I pray no demons from hell, nothing the enemy does or throw at us may contradict or contravene in our lives. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that your perfect will be done. Hallelujah. God, I lay my hand upon your children today in faith, believing, understanding, God, there's a part that the evil eye cannot touch. Amen. You have a part for us. So I pray, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, let there be a divine outpouring, a divine breaking forth, a divine outpouring. Let something spectacular happen in the heart of your children. God, you have given the word and you have told us today what to do. You have shown us what to do. So, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, give us willing hearts. Give us willing hearts. Give us willing minds, willing spirit to heed to your word, not to resist you in any shape or form. For God, you have spoken today. In the name of Jesus Christ, we hear your word, sir. We are willing to follow you, sir. In the name of Jesus Christ, let nothing that you have said fall upon dry ground. But I pray, Jesus, that the power of the Holy Ghost will continue, God, to burn deep down in the heart of your children. Thank you for this message. Thank you for the messenger. Thank you for this message. Thank you for the messenger. Thank you for the revolution that has caused in our lives. And those of us who have come forward, God, and desired to make the adjustment to please you, God. To please you, God. For we are the ones to profit when we say we're going to walk with you all the way. Holy Father, seal these decisions. Seal these vows. Seal this commitment. Bring your children higher. Bring your children closer. Cause there be a breaking forth in the name of Jesus. Cause there to be a breaking forth. Cause a well of rejoicing. A spring of rejoicing. Give tongues where there are no tongues. Grant power where there's no power. Grant a language of rejoicing where there's no rejoicing. Grant testimony where there's no testimony. Lord, I thank you. I thank you. I thank you for the hearing voices. I thank you for the speaking voices. I thank you for the hearing ears. I thank you for the opening eyes. Lord, I pray for healing. Healing is your children's bread. And you say unto us, God, whatever you say, whatever your word says, so will it be. So upon every sick body right now, I declare healing. I believe in healing. I pronounce healing. Every doubting Thomas, I call you back to faith. Praise the Lord. I call you back to faith. Pentecostal faith. Faith that burns. Faith that lives. Faith that ignites. Faith that sets free. Faith that witness. Faith that brings joy. And faith that brings faith into action. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Touch your servant again. Continue to keep the fire burning in her life. Remember everyone who would have heard this message, whether it be through Ustream broadcasts or through cable broadcasts, tape or delay, I pray the same effect or even greater effect. Somebody who's on the verge will say, I heard the voice of Jesus. Lord, this is your final authority. It's your word. And if we go against this, God, we are going against you yourself. So help us to be willing to submit to your final authority, which is the word of God. Today we honor you in Jesus' name. Today we honor you in Jesus' name. Somebody raise your hand. Today we honor you. Today we honor you in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. There's no other authority. There's no other court in the land. There's no other justification or jurisdiction that can plead this. This is God's word. Forever, O Lord. Hayosata. Forever, O Lord. Thy word is settled. My unbelief will not change it. My doubt won't change it. I've got to believe it and accept it. This is the final authority. Hallelujah. Somebody just stand to your feet and just wave your hand and just begin to give God a praise offering. Just in your own words, tell him how much you love him. Tell him how much you thank him for the finality of his word. Yes, Lord God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Nothing can change this. What you say, amen, like the rain come down and the sun come down, like the water cycle is constant, so constant is your word. Like everything you put on is constant, so constant is your word. We human beings failing, we are not constant, we are faulted, we are flawed, but your word is supreme above the reason of man, for your thoughts are higher. Your ways are higher. Your thoughts are higher. And Lord, today we cap into your ways. We cap into your thoughts by believing you. We cap into your ways. We cap into your thoughts by believing what you say. And obeying what you say. And agreeing to align ourselves with the word of God. So if you see me walking differently, is because I'm aligned to the word. If you see me talking differently, it's because I'm aligned to the word. If you can't understand my actions, it's because I'm aligned to the word of God. Oh, hallelujah. It's because I decide my mind to align myself with the word of God, and the word of God is yea and amen.
Thank you, Father.
Oh, God. Amen. Something is just bubbling in my soul. It's sweet. I love the word. I love the word. I love the word. Somebody will have to rejoice. I love the word. I love what the Lord says. I love what the Lord says. Make the adjustment. The word of God not going to adjust to suit you. You have to adjust to suit the word of God. Because God's word is permanent. Put your hand together for the Lord. As you return to your seat. Believers, hold on to what you get. Hold on to the word of God. Don't lose it. Don't fight it. There's an active devil out there trying to discredit everything that the truth set up. But you can do nothing to the truth, the Lord says, because Jesus Christ embodies truth. We're glad for the preacher. Glad for her. Glad for the word of God. Amen. Didn't you feel God among you? Didn't you feel like something going through you when the word of God was being preached? Hallelujah. I love this. God bless you, Minister Reid. Keep on declaring the word of God. Amen. We are going to move to the dining room now. I believe we have a recessional hymn. Do we have a recessional song or something like that? And if you're here visiting and you have to go, we want to shake your hand. But we have meal in the house for everybody. Pardon? Rooted and grounded. That's right. We have a meal in the house for everybody to eat. We'll make the call a little later.